We are very privileged and honored tonight to have with us Dr. Leland Ryken. And I have to tell you a little personal confession. It was 20-something years ago that I read my first Ryken book, and it was called Worldly Saints. And I fell in love more than ever with the Puritans. It's a wonderful description of the Puritans, an anthology of many of their quotes, and it depicts a people who look at every single aspect of life, or try to, from a biblical and Christian perspective, from marriage and sex and families all the way to education. It's a wonderful book, and I've read many others since, but I have not read them all. There are over 30 books that Dr. Ryken has written and over 100 articles examining Milton's Paradise Lost, C.S. Lewis' Narnia Tales, classic works of literature on the Bible itself, the nature of art, work, leisure. But throughout all of the books, the ones I've read, Dr. Ryken consistently brings both a Christian and a scholarly perspective to his subject. Serving on the faculty of Wheaton College since 1968, Dr. Ryken has devoted much of his scholarship to Bible translations and the study of the Bible as literature. He served as literary chairman for the English Standard Version of the Bible, and in 2003 received the Distinguished Gutenberg Award for his contributions to education, writing, and the understanding of the Bible. With his son, Dr. Philip Ryken, pastor of Philadelphia's 10th Presbyterian Church, Dr. Ryken published the Literary Study Bible in 2007, which I used when I read through the Bible last year and learned so much and gained so many insights. So it's a real pleasure for us to have this evening Dr. Philip Ryken. Dr. Leland Ryken.
The Bible as a literary classic. As an epigraph for my address, I've chosen a comment about the Bible that the Russian novelist Dostoevsky put into the mouth of one of his fictional characters. What a book the Bible is. What a miracle. What strength is given with it to people. It is like a mold cast of the world and human nature. Everything is there. And what mysteries are solved and revealed. What a book the Bible is, indeed. My main subject in this address is the literary nature of the Bible, what the concept means, and what follows from the fact that it is a literary book. To cast a fresh light on my subject, I've chosen the format of considering the Bible as a literary classic. Maybe our understanding and appreciation of the wonder of the Bible will be enhanced if we put it into the category of literary classic, and perhaps our understanding of the concept of a literary classic will be enlarged if we consider the Bible as an example of such. I think you will quickly see that we can fit the Bible into the category of literary classic with no strain whatsoever. So what is a classic? Here's a sampling of definitions. A classic modifies our very being and makes us feel we are not the same men and women we were when we began it. Sheldon Sacks, Fiction and the Shape of Belief. A classic lays its images permanently on the mind and is entirely irreplaceable in the sense that no other book whatever comes anywhere near reminding you of it or being even a momentary substitute for it. C.S. Lewis. Among the best of a class, of the highest quality in a group, a literary classic then ranks with the best of its kind that have been produced. The Harper Handbook to Literature. A classic is doubly significant. For it remains significant after it acquires a new significance, after the age for which it was written and the conditions under which it was written have passed away, and yet it keeps, undefaced by handling, the original noble imprint of the mind that first minted it. Arthur Quiller Couch on the use of masterpieces. The classics are books that come down to us bearing upon them the traces of readings previous to ours, and bringing in their wake the traces they themselves have left on the culture or cultures they have passed through. Italo Calvino, Why Read the Classics? What we tend to require for something called a literary classic is a display of great craftsmanship and striking originality. Beyond this, the text must make a powerful emotional and intellectual impact, provide a rich reading experience, and leave behind a larger understanding of our past experience and a new way to think about our lives. In the case of the greatest works, we return to them time and again in our minds as touchstones by which we interpret the world around us. author of a book on the Scarlet Letter. The scholars who formulated the foregoing definitions all had in mind the kind of literature that we teach in courses in English and American literature courses. But I want to quote one other scholar talking about the classic status that the Bible once held in English-speaking cultures. George Lindbeck, a former professor of theology at Yale University, wrote the following late in his teaching career. It's a long quotation. "Until recently, most people in traditionally Christian countries lived in the linguistic and imaginative world of the Bible. It was not the only world in which they dwelt, yet the text above all texts was the Bible. Its stories, images, conceptual patterns, and turns of phrase permeated the culture from top to bottom. This was true even for illiterates and those who did not go to church. For knowledge of the Bible was transmitted not only directly by its reading, hearing, and ritual enactment, but also indirectly by an interwoven net of intellectual, literary, artistic, folkloric, and proverbial traditions. We still speak colloquially of a Samson, or a Solomon, or a Judas, not to mention a Mary or a Martha. There was a time when every educated person, no matter how professedly unbelieving or secular, knew the actual text from Genesis to Revelation. Once classic texts penetrate deeply into the psyche," I'm still quoting, "especially the collective psyche, they cease to be primarily objects of study and rather come to supply the conceptual and imaginative vocabularies with which we construe and construct reality. They have many applications and therefore many meanings. Thus, to take a non-biblical example, Homer's Odyssey has functioned as a metaphor for a wide variety of adventurous journeys or odysseys into distant times and places, and even into the hidden recesses of the mind. To return to our main theme, the Bible has in this respect been preeminent in traditionally Christian lands. Its lenses have functioned as the most powerful, penetrating, and comprehensive ones. So pervasive is this scriptural idiom that much of Western literature consists of subtexts of the biblical text. Thus, all of experience, including sacred texts from other religions, such as the classics of Greece and Rome, was absorbed into the scriptural framework. Christendom dwelt imaginatively in the biblical world." The main point of the essay from which I have quoted is that the English-speaking world has become biblically illiterate. And I know it with sadness, Lindbeck's claim that, quote, "when I first arrived at Yale, even those who came from non-religious backgrounds knew the Bible better than most of those now who come from church-going families." With these thoughts about what constitutes a literary classic in our awareness, I am ready to turn to my main subject of the Bible as literature. I will cover three topics. One, what does it not mean that the Bible is literature? Two, what does it mean that the Bible is literature? Three, what does it mean to approach the Bible as literature? What do I not mean when I claim that the Bible is a predominantly literary book? First, to me, a literary approach to the Bible does not require a person to accept a liberal attitude toward the accuracy and authority of the Bible. In fact, the idea of the Bible as literature begins with, I wonder how you'd answer that. It begins with the Bible. The writers of the Bible refer with technical precision to a whole range of literary genres in which they write: proverb, saying, chronicle, complaint, oracle, apocalypse, parable, song, epistle, and many another. Furthermore, some of the forms that we find in the Bible correspond to the literary forms current in the author's surrounding cultures. For example, the Ten Commandments are cast into the form of suzerainty treaties that ancient Near Eastern kings imposed on their subjects. And the New Testament epistles, despite unique features, show many affinities to Greek and Roman letters of the same era. Mainly, though, we can look to the Bible itself to see the extent to which it is a literary book. Virtually every page of the Bible is replete with literary technique. Most of what we conclude about the Bible as literature is something that we deduce from the actual text, but we should pause to note that there is one writer within the Bible who states flat out what his theory of writing was. The passage comes near the end of the Old Testament book of Ecclesiastes, and it states in kernel form much of what I want to say about the Bible as literature this evening. The statement is this: "Besides being wise, the preacher also taught the people knowledge, weighing and studying and arranging many proverbs with great care. The preacher sought to find words of delight, and uprightly he wrote words of truth, arranging with great care, seeking to find words of delight. Here is the biblical writer as self-conscious artist and literary stylist, aware of literary genres, in this case the proverb. The idea of the Bible as literature started with the writers of the Bible, and the idea was perpetuated by such towering figures from the past as Augustine, Luther, and Calvin, all of whom did not doubt that the Bible has literary qualities. Today, the literary approach to the Bible is widely practiced in evangelical colleges, seminaries, and Bible schools. When I read literary discussions of the Bible as literature by biblical scholars at large, I find the same range of attitudes from conservative to liberal that I find in other types of biblical analysis. When I read literary discussions of the Bible by the scholarly world at large, I find the same range of attitudes from conservative to liberal that I find when I read other kinds of commentary on the Bible. I make it a practice to begin my course in the literature of the Bible with 2 pages of quotations from the Bible, all of them very dear to me, in which biblical writers make claims about the Bible, its inspiration, its reliability, its unique status as being not the word of people but of God. And then I assert that for me, the literary study of the Bible begins where any other study of the Bible begins, by accepting as true all that the Bible says about itself. I find no discord between what I believe theologically about the Bible and my literary study of it. And in fact, I find that the two reinforce each other. A second thing that the concept of the Bible does not mean to me is a common equation of literature and fiction. Fictionality, though common in literature, is not an essential ingredient of it. The properties that make a text literary are unaffected by the historicity or fictionality of the material. A literary approach depends on the writer's selectivity and molding of the material and the style of presentation, regardless of whether the details really happened or are made up. In my expository writing course, I asked my students to write a paper based on a chapter from an autobiography of scientist Lauren Isley. The piece is cast into a narrative form and recounts how Isley, as a little boy, first encountered childhood evil when he was beat up by the town bullies in a place called Green Gulch, just outside of town. The story is as dense with literary technique as any other work that I teach in my literature courses. In fact, I could well teach it in my literature courses. Yet I have no reason to suspect that any detail in the story is anything other than factual. Nor does the presence of artifice and convention in a biblical text necessarily imply fictionality. I sometimes ask my classes to list in sequence the ingredients that go into the phenomenon of falling asleep in class. It turns out that falling asleep in class is a rigidly controlled set of conventions, a veritable ritual action in which we can outline the sequence of events, I would say, with scientific accuracy. Most of what we do in life is made up of conventions. Consider, for example, the convention surrounding the live television sports report. The reporter is filmed with a sports arena in the background. During the course of the report, the reporter either interviews an athlete or is momentarily replaced by a film clip of sports action. It is a rule of the sports interview that the conversation consist only of cliches and that it be devoid of anything approaching intellectual substance. The syntax of the athlete being interviewed is expected to be rudimentary and perhaps even non-existent in the usual sense. It is an absolute requirement that at some point the athlete mumble an inane comment about just trying to go out there and do my job. A look of false modesty is expected to accompany this world-changing pronouncement. Are you tracking with me? At the end of the report, the reporter stares into the camera and utters a catchy, impressive-sounding one-liner. The conventionalized nature of all this is obvious. Every sports report follows the same format. Yet this artifice does not undermine the factuality of the report. The interview is not a fictional event, even though we might wish that it were. There is an unwarranted assumption in some quarters that the presence of literary conventions in the Bible signals that the content is fictional rather than factual. A third fallacy is that to approach the Bible as literature means approaching it only as literature, devoid of the special religious belief and authority that Christians ascribe to the Bible. But again, this is not inherent in the literary approach. any more than paying attention to the history or language of the Bible implies being interested only in those things. To sum up, it would be tragic if we allowed ourselves to be deterred from a literary approach to the Bible because of objections that turn out to be fallacies. To view the Bible as literature does not require one to regard it as fictional or to compromise one's view of its special religious authority. What then does it mean to view the Bible as a predominantly literary book or anthology? Before I answer that question, let me quote a few literary passages from the Bible and encourage you to ponder how this material differs from expository or informational writing of the type we usually encounter in our daily routine. Oh, that he would kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. For your love is better than wine. Behold, you are beautiful, my love. Behold, you are beautiful. Your eyes are doves. I compare you, my love, to a mare of Pharaoh's chariots. Now, Eglon was a very fat man, and Ehud came to him as he was sitting alone in his cool roof chamber, and Ehud said, I have a message from God for you. And he arose from his seat, and Ehud reached with his left hand, took the sword from his right thigh, and thrust it into his belly. And the hilt also went in after the blade, and the fat closed over the blade, for he did not pull the sword out of his belly. Then the angel said to me, lift your eyes and see what this is that goes forth. And I said, what is it? He said, this is the measuring container for cereal that goes forth. And behold, there was a woman sitting inside the cereal container. And he said, I'm rendering it a bit colloquial, please meet wickedness. And he thrust her back into the container. Then I lifted my eyes and saw two women who had wings like the wings of a stork, and they lifted up the container between earth and heaven. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. Rising early in the morning to bless your neighbor with a loud voice will be counted as cursing. What would you say most obviously characterizes the passages that I have read? I am impressed right off by the range of the material, from the wildly poetic flourish of comparing a woman's attractiveness to doves and horses, to the realism in the case of the disappearing sword, to the bit of fantasy about a woman named Wickedness sitting inside a cereal container, to the idealized pastoral world of green pastures and still waters, to a wry proverb about the trials of living with an early riser, or of being an early riser and having your cheerfulness spurned. Let me just note in passing that one of the very great advantages of a literary approach to the Bible is that it dispels the common tendency in our circles to act as though the Bible is all one type of material and to flatten it out in the process. The Bible is a book, an anthology actually, notable for its rich variety of material and style, and a literary approach is capable of showing this. Another thing that leaps out immediately from the quoted passages is that this is pretty entertaining stuff, rather daring, actually. And along with that, it is highly imaginative. You and I, for example, would not have thought of comparing an attractive woman to a horse, would we now? The Bible is an entertaining rather than a dull book, and literary analysis is capable of showing this, too. There was latent humor in some of the passages that I read, wasn't there? Might a literary approach open our eyes to this? And in fact, give us terms as well as an incentive to talk about it. I recall an occasion when I was teaching the Bible as literature one summer at Regent College in Vancouver, British Columbia, and a local newspaper, obviously on a slow news day, sent someone out to interview me. Early in the interview, I spoke about the humor that I had discussed that day in connection with the story of Jacob. The reporter, who obviously had a low view of Christians, could hardly get over the fact of humor in the Bible. And she found it hard to cover anything else in the interview. Do you mean that your students actually laughed in class? She asked incredulously. I have often looked back in regret to a situation in which Christians could have conveyed the impression, or in which an outsider could have gotten the impression, that Christians are humorless people. A lot was codified for me when, after I had taught two Sunday school sessions on the realism of the Bible and humor in the Bible, a class member shared with me that it was these very qualities of the Bible that had been instrumental in his coming to faith, inasmuch as they confirmed for him the validity of the Bible. Then he looked at me and asked, what kind of book would the Bible be without its realism and humor? A further aspect of the experiential quality of the passages that I quoted is the concreteness of the language.
Did you notice how the passages kept us rooted in the world of concrete everyday reality? A world of horses and swords and measuring containers and pastures and streams and loud voices early in the morning? Listen to the opening of Psalm 23 again. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. This is obviously artistic in its expression, in the specific verse form of parallelism, stating a similar thought or feeling twice in different words and images, but similar grammatical form. Really, all the passages that I read have their own form of artistry and beauty, an artistry and beauty that elevate them above the ordinary expository use of language with which we conduct our usual business. The passages that I read obviously rely on special resources of language. They use poetic imagery, green pastures and still waters, metaphor, your eyes are doves, simile, wings like the wings of a stork, personification, a woman named Wickedness, and analogy or comparison, kisses better than wine. It all sounds like stuff you would read in a literature course. Indeed, it is like what you read in a literature course, and that is my main point this evening. To sum up, the content of literature is recognizable human experience, not primarily abstract propositions. A work of literature is not primarily a delivery system for an idea. Literary content is embodied in distinctly literary genres, like poetry and narrative, and makes use of special resources of language, like metaphor and simile. And literature displays obvious artistry. When judged by these criteria, how much of the Bible is literary in nature? I believe that 80% is not an exaggeration, and that with a generous application of my literary criteria, the percentage is higher. Let me note in passing that the Bible is a hybrid book that combines three chief types of writing or impulses: literary, historical, and theological. Most passages are a mixture of these, but more often than not, the history and theology are embodied in a literary form. Now, the fact that the Bible is literary does not guarantee that people will approach it in keeping with its literary nature. In fact, most people do not approach it in terms of what it is. What then does it mean to approach the Bible as literature? To read and interpret the Bible as literature, we need to do justice to the things that I have said make the Bible literary in nature. This extends to both content and form or technique. I propose that we look at content first. The subject of literature is human experience, as distinct from ideas or propositions. Literature is concrete and experiential. It does not discourse about virtue, for example, but instead shows a virtuous person acting. Literature is based on the premise of showing rather than telling, embodiment rather than abstraction. The knowledge that literature imparts consists of our living through of an experience. The knowledge that literature imparts consists of our living through of an experience. The sixth commandment tells us propositionally, you shall not murder. The story of Cain and Abel incarnates that same truth, but without using the abstraction murder and without commanding us to refrain from it. The essential mark of literature is to be concrete, experiential, human, vivid, and direct. Psalm 1 does not tell us life presents us with a choice. Instead, it presents the choice itself in the form of a contrast between two characters. Literature is incarnational. It embodies meaning and ideas in concrete form. Several important corollaries follow from the incarnational nature of literature. Because the aim of a literary text is to recreate an experience rather than develop a logical argument in essay fashion, the first item on the agenda for the reader and expositor is to relive the text as vividly and concretely as possible. That is the most basic rule that I try to inculcate in my students. A literary text seeks to encompass us in a whole world of the imagination, not to point beyond itself as quickly and transparently as possible to a body of information. To extend what Kenneth Bailey said about the parables specifically, a literary text is not a delivery system for an idea. It is not like a shell casing that can be discarded once the idea, the shell, is fired. Rather, it is a house in which the reader or listener is invited to take up residence. The reader is encouraged to look out on the world from the point of view of the text. Let me repeat. A literary text is not a delivery system for an idea. Rather, it is a house in which the reader or listener is invited to take up residence. The reader is encouraged to look out on the world from the point of view of the text. The fact that a literary text embodies an experience means that the whole story or the whole poem is the meaning. There is something irreducible about a literary text. I am not opposed to deducing propositions from a work of literature, but the propositions that we deduce from a literary text are never an adequate substitute for the meanings that the work itself communicates. Flannery O'Connor's way of asserting this was, the whole story is the meaning, the whole story is the meaning, because it is an experience, not an abstraction. The literary impulse to incarnate human experience or reality also has implications for how we view the truth that the Bible communicates. We usually think of truth in terms of ideas only. Truth, ideas. But the truthfulness of literature is another type of truth, namely, truthfulness to experience or reality. Our ability to see this type of truth or reality in the Bible is rendered easy because of a further trait of literature, the fact that it embodies universal human experience. Literature never goes out of date. As Ezra Pound put it, literature is news that stays news. We can profitably contrast history and literature in this regard. History tells us what happened, while literature tells us what happens, what is true for all people at all times. A text can be both, and the Bible is both. But when it is literary, it is universal as well as historically specific. This premise of continuing relevance underlies any good sermon or Bible study, confirming my claim that good Bible expositors practice an incipient literary criticism. The Bible is more than a work of literature, but it is not less. My favorite text for convincing my students that literature takes universal human experience as its subject is the story of Cain and Abel in Genesis 4, partly because the apparent remoteness of the primitive and ancient world of that text makes it an unlikely candidate to be as up-to-date as the daily news. The list of universal, recognizable human experiences in the story of Cain and Abel is nearly inexhaustible. Let me name some of these experiences. Violence, and specifically domestic violence. Sibling rivalry, including the spectacle of siblings who are temperamental opposites. The model child, the problem child, the guilty child, lying to a parent, the domineering older sibling and the put-upon younger sibling, lack of self-control, envy, self-pity, harboring a grudge, temptation, giving in to an evil impulse, the futile attempt to conceal a crime, anger at having gotten caught, the attempt to evade responsibility, am I my brother's keeper? Moral indifference, the criminal without regret, the judge, arrest, trial, and sentencing, the appeal of a sentence and modification of it, making a bad decision and having to live with the consequences. In claiming that the story of Cain and Abel tells us what happens, I am not questioning that it also tells us what happened on the family farm on a fatal day early in human history, nor that this story is laden with moral and theological content. Yet a touchstone that allows us to gauge whether an expositor has taken a literary approach to a text is the degree to which that person has been sensitive to the universal human experience in it. Of course, it is possible to choose literary passages for exposition and yet fail to treat them in a literary manner. The most common form of this failure is to reduce literary texts to abstract propositions. Instead of reliving a story, teachers and preachers regularly state a series of generalizations, perhaps dipping into a biblical text for proof text in support of the ideas that are the main focus. I have a colleague in the CE department at Wheaton who made a survey of Bible study and curriculum materials on the Psalms, and he found that overwhelmingly these sources replace the images of the Psalms with a series of abstract propositions. The result is that in our circles, we have slipped into thinking of the Bible as a theological outline with proof texts attached. Last spring, I attended a session on hymnody in which someone with a PhD in musicology surveyed what the Bible tells us about hymns in the church. The speaker's outline for the Song of Moses was almost completely abstract. I quote, a song of deliverance, God's judgment, God's works and ways, fulfillment of God's word, God's attributes, greatness, power, justice, truth, holiness, righteousness, end of quotation. How could someone with artistic intuition say nothing about the actual texture of the poem? Nothing about those glorious images of the blast of God's nostrils, the waters piled up, the horse and his rider thrown into the sea. How could that happen? It's not hard to figure that out. We all handle the Bible in keeping with the models that we have been provided, and the dominant model for dealing with the Bible is to turn it into theological abstractions. Knowing that literature is a concrete embodiment of human experience can help us interact with the Bible in terms of the kind of writing it really is. If literature is definable partly by its experiential content, it is also characterized by its form and technique. The most common way of defining literature is by its genres, or literary types. Through the centuries, people have agreed that certain genres, such as story, poetry, and drama, are literary in nature. Other genres, like historical chronicles, theological treatises, and genealogies, are expository or informational in nature. Still others fall into one category or the other, depending on how the writer handles them. Letters, sermons, and orations, for example, can move in the direction of literature if they display the ordinary elements of literature. The four big literary genres in the Bible are story, poetry, vision, and epistle. Each of these categories has numerous subtypes. Did the writers of the Bible write in an awareness of these literary forms? Yes, they did. For one thing, as I noted earlier, some biblical writers refer with technical precision to various literary genres, such as proverb, saying, oracle, complaint, and such like. But it is even more evident from their writings themselves that the writers of the Bible were literary craftsmen with the knowledge of literary forms. The writers of historical narrative knew how to tell stories with well-made plots and vivid characterization. The poets knew that a lament psalm had five main parts and that a psalm of praise was expected to have a three-part structure. The importance of genres in the Bible is that each has its own mode of operation and rules for interpretation. These should affect how we read and interpret a biblical text. As readers and interpreters, we need to come to a given text with the right expectations. If we do, we will see more than we would otherwise see, and we will avoid misreadings. Literary genre should program our encounter with a text. A literary approach to the Bible will require biblical expositors to enlarge their list of genres and let their knowledge of how each genre works control what they do with Bible passages more thoroughly than they usually do. But it will not require a sophisticated set of critical tools. In fact, mastering the tools of literary analysis that are taught in a typical high school or college literature course is the best starting point. Biblical scholars, with their love of things ancient and the specialized knowledge that they have acquired in seminary and graduate school, of course claim that interpreting the Bible requires a special hermeneutic, not the general hermeneutic that we apply to literature generally. I disagree with that orientation. I was so disappointed when Robert Alter, in his book, The Art of Biblical Narrative, abandoned his literary moorings and claimed that, quote, as modern readers, we have lost most of the keys, end of quotation, that will unlock Old Testament stories. We have not lost the keys of interpreting biblical literature. The keys are the familiar ones of plot conflict leading to resolution, techniques of characterization, the role of setting in a story, dramatic irony, the dynamics of imagery and metaphor, ordinary genre criticism for forms like satire and lyric and such like. If you are saying to yourself, oh, but the Bible is rooted in an ancient world with mores and viewpoints far different from ours, my answer is that is true for every body of literature that I teach. When I teach Homer or Chaucer or Shakespeare or Dickens, I do not throw up my hands and say, oh, this is so remote from my world that I have lost the keys to understanding it. Close reading of the text will provide most of the clues we need for interpretation, to which we can add a modicum of historical context, probably provided in any scholarly edition of the text that we teach. I regard the literary approach to the Bible as the common reader's best friend. Literary critic Mary Ellen Chase entitled her 1944 book, The Bible and the Common Reader, and I endorse the concept. Regardless of the genre in which a given work is written, literature is identifiable by its special resources of language, and attention to them is another mark of an approach that is genuinely literary. Reliance on literary resources of language can occur in texts that we would not consider to be primarily literary, and wherever they appear, they require literary analysis. A discourse becomes literary, for example, when a writer exploits such resources of language as metaphor, simile, allusion, pun, paradox, and irony. These are the very essence of poetry. But in the Bible, they appear everywhere, not just in the poetry. This is why, incidentally, a literary approach is necessary for the whole Bible, and not just the predominantly literary parts. All that I have said about the nature of literature explains why a literary approach to the Bible is preoccupied with literary form and technique, with how biblical writers express themselves. In any form of discourse, meaning is communicated through form. The concept of form should be construed very broadly in this context. It includes anything that touches upon how a writer has expressed the content of an utterance. The how is the form. Everything that gets communicated does so through form, beginning with language itself. While this is true for all forms of writing, it is especially crucial for literature. Literature has its own forms and techniques, and these tend to be more complex and subtle and indirect than those of ordinary discourse. Stories, for example, communicate their meaning through character, setting, and action. To understand a story, we must first interact with the form, that is, the character, settings, and events. Poetry conveys its meanings through figurative language and concrete images. It is therefore impossible to determine what a poem says without first encountering the form, that is, the metaphors, similes, and images. The literary critic's preoccupation with the how of biblical writing is not frivolous. It is indeed evidence of an artistic delight in verbal beauty and craftsmanship, but it is also part of an attempt to understand what the Bible says. In a literary text, it is impossible to separate what is said from how it is said, content from form. In saying that, I do not, however, wish to discredit the aesthetic dimension of a literary approach to the Bible as having value in itself. The writer of Ecclesiastes, I remind you, sought to find words of delight. A literary approach to the Bible is ready to grant value to the literary skill of the writers and the delight that this skill can provide. Let me say again that endorsing the concept of the Bible as literature does not guarantee that a reader or interpreter will apply those convictions when interacting with the biblical text. Most members of a guild of biblical scholars will agree with virtually everything that I've said in this address, but they give very little evidence of that when they interact with the Bible. This is true also of our own students, including English majors. Unless they are instructed and coached to apply the methods of literary analysis that they learn in literature courses to the Bible, they will, if left to their own designs, follow the models that they have learned in their Bible courses. Is the Bible a literary classic? The immediate response for most of us in this room is no. The Bible is the Word of God to us. If I have done my job adequately this evening, I trust that upon reflection, you will agree with me that to speak of the Bible as a literary classic is to identify accurately the form in which God chose to give his word to us. One of the widely assumed fallacies in our circles is to think that the literary aspects of the Bible are only the form in which the content of the Bible is expressed, only the form. But the word only is not placed correctly in that statement. The literary aspects of the Bible are not only the form in which the content comes to us, they are the only form in which the content comes to us. There can be no message without the form in which it is embodied. The foundation on which all biblical interpretation needs to rest is that we cannot extract meaning from a literary text in the Bible without first interacting with aspects of literary form. One good index to the Bible's status as a literary classic is statements that have been made by experts who know a classic when they read one. I want to end with a few choice quotations along these lines, made either by famous authors or well-known literary critics. The Bible is one of the great primary books in Western literature. The only other members of the class to which it belongs are Homer and the Greek tragic poets, Howard Mumford Jones. The poems of the Bible, not in their divine argument alone, but in the very critical art of composition, may be easily made appear over all the kinds of lyric poesy to be incomparable. John Milton. The Old and New Testaments are the great code of art. William Blake. It takes a story to make a story. It takes a story of mythic dimensions, one which belongs to everybody, one in which everybody is able to recognize the hand of God in its descent. In the Protestant South, the scriptures fill this role. Flannery O'Connor. More than I have experienced in all other books put together, the words of the Bible find me at a greater depth of my being. Did you ever meet any book that went to your heart so often and so deeply? Are not other books wonderfully efficacious in proportion as they resemble the Bible? Samuel Taylor Coleridge. This story is one of two stories that have haunted us and followed us from our beginnings. I'll just pause to say it's John Steinbeck on the story of Cain, specifically. This story is one of two stories that have haunted us and followed us from our beginnings. No story has power, nor will it last, unless we feel in ourselves that it is true and true for us, true of us. I think that this is the best known story in the world because it is everybody's story. I think it is the symbol story of the human soul. Steinbeck also said, regarding a movie based on the Bible, saw the movie, loved the book. Ernest Hemingway and I, when we first knew each other, both in our early 20s, agreed that there was just no narrative to beat parts of Samuel, Kings, and Chronicles, John Dos Passos. There is not a single point that can be urged as to the educational importance of the Greek classics, which does not tell equally in favor of the biblical classics, Richard G. Moulton. The Bible forms the lowest stratum in the teaching of literature. It should be taught so early and so thoroughly that it sinks straight to the bottom of the mind, where everything that comes along later can settle on it. Northrop Frye. The greatest English classic, title of a book by C. Boyd McAfee. The supreme book of mankind, title of a book by James McClure. The greatest English text, Mark Shorer. The Bible invites the response of all great literature, wonder, delight, exaltation. It achieves, as we read, a strange authority and power as a work of literature. It becomes one with the Western tradition because it is its single greatest source, T.R. Henn. The Bible is the best of classics the world has ever admired. The best of classics the world has ever admired. McGuffey's Fifth Eclectic Reader, the first source to use the phrase, the best of classics for the Bible. The preacher sought to find words of delight. Thank you.